Hi, welcome back. This is our first episode of season two and our fifth episode overall. I'm your host, Hojune Kwak. I'm a media major. I'm a second year and a MIR student. And we have...
Oh, hello, everyone. My name is Daniel Villegas, and I am a fourth year microbiology student from Revel.
Hello, I'm Nadia. I am also a fourth year student. I am also in Revel, but I am in... Okay, it's a mouthful. Environmental science, ecology, behavior, and evolutions major.
Hi, I'm Deja. I'm a first year in MIR College, and I'm a general biology major.
Hey, y'all. I'm Jawon from ERC. I'm a biochem cell bio major, and I'm a first year.
Yeah, so our first podcast of spring quarter, it'll be a special one because Trident Day was happened last Saturday. So we're going to do an FAQ for some questions we found online on Reddit, College Confidential, and Facebook. So one of the first questions we found was, what is the average day like? What do you guys do for fun? How social are the weekends? I'm a bit worried that since there's a stereotype of UCSD being socially dead, weekends for me would be boring since I'll be dorming. By Reddit user Ilcha.
Oh. Well, I think a lot of it depends on, you know, you as a person, you know, whether... I know some people think it's kind of bullshit, the extrovert or introvert thing, but, you know, it really does matter, you know, your perspective, you know, if you're, like, an outgoing person or if you kind of just are reserved. Because if you're a reserved person, you're definitely going to have more of a, you know, quiet experience, I guess. And that's just speaking from experience, because I myself was pretty reserved most of my life. So, you know, I didn't really go to a lot of parties and stuff, but... it's still fun, you know, being on campus and stuff like that. You know, go to the gym or just getting food out. You know, you see other students doing the same thing. So, you know, it just depends on perspective, I think.
I mean, yeah, I agree with that entirely. I definitely was super concerned about that myself when I first got admitted. I actually got to the point, I had Sonoma State as my backup, and I hated it. I was, like, not going to go there. But when I found out that UCSD was known as UC Socially Dead, I actually started to reconsider, but I mean, looking back, I mean, thank God I didn't, because it's definitely, like, it's so true, it's what you make of it. Like, in high school, I never went to any parties or anything like that either. I'm not gonna get into it, but I mean, I did some partying in college, not a lot, but it's, like, if I wanted to go out and have, like, a good night or, like, a really fun time with people, if I tried, I could do it. Where it's, like, if I waited for an event to come to me or, like, for someone to invite me out, then it wouldn't necessarily happen.
Right.
So I definitely don't think the socially dead stigma applies. But, I mean, what do you guys think?
I guess I'm more of an indoors person, so I have fun inside, like, video games and all that stuff. But I have friends who go out all the time, and they're like, can you watch my stuff? I'm going out to a party, or I'm going out here, and I'm like... I got you. So
yeah.
It depends what you're into, I guess. Because there's a way to have fun. And I have a lot of friends who stay inside. I have friends who go outside campus all the time. So it is what you make of it. What do you, you know, how do you have fun? You could probably do it. There's a lot of opportunities.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Pretty much same. I'll just kind of be reiterating what everyone said so far. Depends on your own definition of fun. For me, fun is kind of just hanging out. I don't really need to go off campus to have fun. So I just make some friends and spend time with them. And that's fun for me. So... as far as I'm concerned, UC's not socially dead at all.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
There's plenty of, like, student orgs you can join, like The Guardian, and there's also, like, if you're into improv, there's, like, Foosh. If you're into, like, satire, there's the MQ. And also, even though not too many students at UCSD are in frats, there are frats, and there's no, like, limit to how many. How many students can be in a frat, so there's just a lot of options for that.
Yeah, I definitely think that's true. Like, I've been part of so many organizations over the course of the 4 years here. Many of them I've stuck with, most of them I've dropped. But I, like I said, I've never had a problem where it's like I want to join a club and I couldn't find something. My comic book club is out there if you're into that. Like you were saying, you're more into staying in. There is an RPG club. I've actually never been to their meetings, but I heard they're really fun.
Oh, they are, yeah.
Oh, nice.
There's Triton Gaming. They're a group that does, I think they mostly play Smash, but I mean, it's gaming. There's definitely something for everyone. Like,
and if not, just start yourself, because I'm sure there'll be other people with the same interests.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And the next question is about dorm life. So the question is, what are the dorms like in Revel like? I've heard they are subpar, but it might be outdated information. By read user JSEFFF.
Well, yeah, it depends which res hall you are in, I guess. I was in the fleets.
Oh, so you were?
Like, yeah. Same. So like out there, right? Yeah, there's those, and then there's Argo and Blake. I didn't get to spend any time in those, but I personally had a really, really good time, despite being like, you know, crowned with like 12 other or 14 other people, actually, five triple rooms, three in each, right? Three people in each. But it was just a lot of fun. Everybody got along great. You know, there's only two bathrooms, two showers,
in per the suite, suites, right?
Per suite, 15
yeah. People for sharing.
15 people sharing that. But you know, surprisingly, I rarely had to wait on someone to take a dump or something like that.
It was a rare occasion.
It was actually a rare occasion, you know, yeah. Surprisingly.
Yeah, last year I lived in Tioga of Muir as a freshman, and it was, I really liked it, especially because of our two HAs. They were really great. They really paid attention to their housemates, and yeah, it was someone who never lived like dorm life before. I'm sure most of you haven't either. It was really a fun experience, especially for the first year of college life.
Yeah, and really convenient too, because you can, it gets you, it lets you adapt, make that transition. Yeah. You know, you can just roll out of bed, go to a class. I mean, sure, you don't want to be doing that, you know, for the rest of your life, but definitely it's a good, easy way to start.
Yeah, you know. Definitely. I mean, you guys are currently in dorm life.
I'm in an apartment.
Oh, you're in an apartment. Yeah. How did you get in an apartment?
Named housing.
So. Oh, which apartment?
The Tuolumne apartments, LGBT, oh, okay. The LGBT themed
nice,
housing.
Nice. Oh man, well, you're a lucky freshman.
Yeah.
Oh, but how are you?
I'm in Europe Hall and ERC. They're all like the little halls named after different geographical locations. I'm in the middle. I'm in Europe, right next to Ellie's Garden.
How are you liking it?
The res halls are. The lounge spaces are really huge, and there's a lot of room for you to do whatever you want, set up whatever you want, and do things. But as far as the rooms go themselves, they're really narrow. Like, it's a bunch of triples, five triples, and then a single per suite. We have three showers and three toilets, though, so that's nice. But as far as the rooms themselves, they're really small, and they're really narrow, so it's a lot of having to cramp all my stuff in one space, because I got the loft. So, like, 70% of the room that I had is taken up by the bed and the desk. So then it's like, okay, where does my stuff go? So I just kind of shove it under the desk and hopefully it all fits.
Yeah, I had a loft too, actually. Yeah, it's so I totally get it.
So if you get to move in first, do not do the loft. Anything but the loft.
Well, the thing is, they assign your bed space.
People don't always pay attention to that.
A lot of times, yeah, people don't pay attention to that. But, you know, yeah, you don't have to really follow it. Nobody's going to really check. It's just if there's any damage to a bed, I guess, that's when, or, you know, room damage, then you have to deal with, you know, fees and stuff like that at the end of the year. But,
yeah. Like, how have you guys felt about, like, your room assignments? Like, I'm guessing you guys probably went random in terms of who you roomed with. Like, how's everyone here, for the most part, had positive experiences with how that was set up?
Yeah, me and my roommate are, like, the same people. Like, we both, like, stay inside. Yeah, yeah. Or we do, like, the same things together, watch TV. We both enjoy the darkness and the window closed. So we had a lot of similarities.
That's good.
And I chose a double, so there's, like, enough room. Because I've been inside other triples and, like, dorms, and during the summer I stayed in the dorms, and I've always had a double, and a double's always been a good experience, but I've seen triples, and I'm like, this is horrendous.
Triple, there's a lot more room for conflict. You know, you said you like the you know, the darkness in the room, right? The window's closed. I remember constantly, freshman year, the window would be opening and closing all the time. like I'd close it, and then, like, one of our roommates, like, would come in and then open it, and it was just a battle, you know. But we never had any altercation, you know.
Speaking of room assignments, you can choose your roommates as long as, say you're going to live in triple, as long as you find, like, two other people to room with you, you can choose, you get to, you have a really high chance of actually living with them for, you know, your first school year. Although
they have to be in the same college, though, right?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, same college. And also, if, say, you are assigned to a triple, you can't just find one person room with them, because that would be sort of unfair to the third person, so they don't allow it, I guess. But, and one way to find, you know, if you don't have any friends from your high school that are coming to UCSD that you want to room with, you can always go to the Facebook group, I think it's UCSD class of 2021. Yeah, there's a Facebook group for that, if you're not aware. And you can search for people to room with there. Oh, and another part, a big part of campus life is dying dollars. And a lot of people, as people who have lived at least a quarter, know how terrible dying dollars are. But since you might not be aware, let's just talk about that and how to best deal with your dying dollars. Okay, so I'll go first. First, always get the cheapest dining plan, no matter what. Because first off, dining dollars, although they're not as worth as much as a dollar, you have to pay a dollar. It's a 1-to-1 ratio to get a single dining dollar. So what you have to do is get the smallest dining plan, and if you run out, just use Trident Cash, because with Trident Cash, unlike dining dollars, you can deposit money into it and withdraw money into it. So it's just using like regular money.
And there's a discount too if you use Trident Cash at dining halls.
No. That's only for a community dining plan. That doesn't apply to Trident. Yeah,
Did they change that?
Yeah, they changed that.
Yeah, and if you happen to be in love with dining hall food, I guess you could.
As we all are.
you could buy dining dollars from other students at the end.
Yeah.
And that's usually a pretty good deal because you can get like at a 1-to-2 ratio. Basically, you'll pay one real dollar for 2 dining dollars. So, you end up paying half price for everything in dining dollars.
Yep, definitely. So always get the cheapest dining plan. Mm-hmm. There's no reason to get anything larger.
Yeah,
agreed.
What would you guys say is probably the best dining hall on campus?
I mean, I'm partial to Pines because I live right next to Pines. Yeah. Pines isn't bad.
Pines is average.
It's average, really.
Like, Pines is like set hours where they're always crowded and when they're completely barren. Mm. Like, there's no in between, but I'm really close.
Yeah.
So, I like Revel. Enough, 64. But Revel food is kind of plain, but I like plain food, so it's good for me.
Okay, so yeah,
and then there are places on campus that are like, I wouldn't go to Cafe V because it's so far, that's it.
Yeah.
And I've never been to Warren, and then some places are just really expensive.
Well, Warren's gross, don't do Warren.
Really? Yeah, don't do Warren.
I really like Warren.
You
like
Warren, really?
Yeah. Why?
That's
great.
A first.
No, it's fine.
What do you like about Warren?
What do you like about it?
I think I've been to all the dining halls, but personally, I really like CV. I think their burgers are really good, and then to me, there just seems to be so much variety, because I've always wanted to eat salad, but like, let's say, for example, I go to Pines, their variety as far as the salad bar, it's like, where are the vegetables? Where do I make my salad? But if I go to CV, they have like all the fruit and they actually have grapes.
Yeah.
Like CV for me has a lot of variety. So I'm thinking this is really cool. It's kind of far, but if I ever find myself in Warren, it's there and it's pretty cool.
By the way, CV is Canyon View.
Is that Canyon Vista?
Canyon Vista.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, Canyon Vista.
Canyon Vista.
Okay.
Taste-wise, I think Ocean View. It's the Ocean View. They have pretty good pizza. They renovated it recently, including the food.
Yeah.
And albeit expensive, it's pretty good. And they have the best smoothies by far. And apparently, they call themselves 24/7, but the only part that's 24/7 is like the bakery. And
You get pizza, like a 2 a.m. croissant.
1 a.m. Yeah. You can get pizza until like 1 a.m., right? I think so.
It
closes at 1 a.m., so that's the pizza bar at least. I really like Goodies. Goodies is pretty good. I think it's a safe bet. I don't get tired of it. I think that's my issue. Like, not issue. That's what I like about it. I don't really get tired of it because it's a lot of flavors.
If you like Chipotle, honestly, it's basically just like campus knockoff Chipotle.
There you go.
And the guacamole is free.
And the guac is free, so you don't have to
That has to be new, because I feel like I remember paying for the guac when I was on campus.
Really?
I totally feel like I definitely did, yeah, because I'm one of those, like, I will always get the guac, I don't care how much more expensive it is.
they don't charge extra for that.
Oh, man. Things have changed since on-campus life.
And so another hot topic that we're going to talk about is majors and minors, declaring them and capped majors, and how to get into them. So let's just recap on what our majors are. So I'm a visual arts major, pretty easy to get into. It's not impacted at all.
I'm a microbiology major. I don't think it's too. I mean, there's a lot of bio majors here at UCSD for sure. Microbiology, I don't know if it's probably one of the less common ones, but you know, I haven't had to switch or anything like that. So,
I'm environmental systems major, ecology, behavior, evolution. It's pretty similar to. I mean, it's not as like chem and physics heavy as a lot of the other bio majors. It's a lot more biology and ecology based. It's definitely not hard to get into. I came in undeclared because I thought I wanted to be gen bio, but I didn't really think about the fact that it'd be really hard to get into. But yeah, when I decided to declare that major, it was like super easy. It wasn't any problems with it at all.
I came in as a general bio major, but like the first few weeks in, I switched to ecology, behavior, and evolution, but they didn't coincide with the classes I was going to take because I want to be pre-vet. So then I switched back to gen bio, and there was no hassle. It was easy to switch in between the two bio majors.
Good.
I also came in undeclared, and then I switched to bio, chem, cell, bio, which I thought was going to be extremely difficult. So I'm like, it's a cap major. Like, oh, no, I'm not going to get in. Like, it happened, like, within the next 2 days. And I was like, oh, nice. Okay, I'm a bio, chem, cell, bio major now.
Yeah, that's good.
And some of the impacted majors include gen bio.
CS.
Yes.
Yeah, oh my god, CS is
so bad.
Computer like, science. That's oh man, I feel bad for them. neuroscience, economics, mathematics, public health, bioengineering, computer science and engineering, electrical and
ECE,
computer engineering,
yeah, all that.
And a few others. But to get into an impacted major, if you're undeclared, each major has its own requirements to get into. And up till this year, Gen Bio did not, but I believe it will next year. So something you may not know right now is that currently OCHEM is an upper div class, which means you have to have, junior standing.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Or is it? Well, isn't it sophomore?
I took it sophomore standing.
So okay. You have to have at least a sophomore or junior standing to take upper div classes. However, apparently OCHEM is going to be a lower div class next year.
What?
So, which means that there's a high chance that instead of Gen Bio being a first come first serve type of deal, you'll have to apply to Gen Bio if you're an undeclared major.
Wow.
So yeah, you heard it here first.
For sure.
And definitely, if you're thinking of transferring into a different major, you should do it now rather than later, because you have to take all the classes required to get into it, and you want a good GPA for that as well.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if you're dreaming of getting into the computer science.
Yeah, that's it's like a lottery.
Yeah. And oh, another one was, how do you get into the pre-med major, or if there is one? But
I don't think we have a pre-med.
Yeah, exactly. There's no pre-med
it's
program.
It's kind of just like you take the classes that are required in the future, but it's not really like a assigned program.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of hopefully have a mentor about that.
Yeah.
So if you have any like pre-med schools you're interested in, just look up which classes they require. And just take those classes at UCSD. You can be any major. You could be like a Viz Arts major or a philosophy major,
you're going to graduate in 6 years.
It would probably be better if you were like a gen bio major or chemistry major.
Right, because of the overlap of classes that you've probably taken already for your major.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Something that UCSD does that I remember I thought was really interesting when I was going in, how it works might have changed a little since I last looked at it, since it was 4 years ago. But they had this like build your own major program, where it's like if there was something you wanted to major in and there wasn't an existing major for it, you could actually like talk to an advisor, figure out what other schools do, and then kind of make your own class schedule based off of that. And I know they said it was super common for people who wanted to go into like video game design, or I can't think of anything else off the top of my head, but basically just things where it's like you pretty much need to have training to do it, but it's not a typical major. Pre-med I know isn't one of those because enough students are interested in doing that, so they usually just say go a bio track. But if you are one of those students who you really want to do something kind of obscure but cool, UCSD is kind of a good place for that. I would definitely say just like talk to your advisor.
Plus there's also like professional frats you can get into or clubs. Like I think a big one is MedLife. There's a lot of pre-med students there that you can talk with and consult.
Do you guys want to go over like the different college GEs a little bit?
Oh yeah, sure.
So that's something I think confuses a lot of people.
So Muir is the best college.
Not gonna lie, when it comes to GEs, you do have everyone else beat there.
Yeah.
Like, even geographically, we're in the middle, so nowhere is too far. Like, if you live in ERC and you have a class in Revel or Sixth, then I'm sorry.
It's like,
yeah, that's true. Revel is basically on the edge, so you're gonna be far from a lot unless you're taking like a lot of those science classes where they're all the classes are like in York or Galbraith. You know, you have that advantage, I guess, when you're taking lab courses, you know, bio labs.
Yeah.
But if you're living in Revel, that is.
Yeah, I liked living in Revel just for the sake of having like Galbraith right next door. I had an 8 a.m. chem class, and I would roll out of bed at 7:50 and
too.
Be there on time.
Me too.
Yeah.
And even like that, I couldn't make it sometimes. Even like that, I would sometimes miss, but you know.
Oh, and back on the college GEs, I recommend, and I think everyone would agree, to get your writing courses done with before anything else, if possible. Especially, I'm not sure with the other colleges, but for the Muir writing course, there's two writing classes you have to take, Muir 40 and Muir 50, and you only get priority for those classes if you're first or second year. If you're third year, third or fourth year, it's going to be really hard to get into. So make sure you get into those classes at ASAP.
Yeah.
Oh. How is it for Revel?
For Revel, yeah. For Revel, you got to take the humanities sequence. And
it's five classes.
Five classes. You can take the three of them here and the other two online. That's what I'm going to do.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Because it's like, why would I make my life harder? Because, yeah, those classes are not, you know, they're not fun. For me, at least. I don't know.
No, I feel you there. One thing, actually, I'm going to just, like, segue a little bit. I will kind of want to just describe the college system at UCSD because it's really weird. I think there's only like one other university in the U.S. that does it the way we do. Most schools, your college is determined by your major. So it's like there's the bio college or like the physical sciences and the arts college. UCSD, any major more or less can be in any college. That doesn't mean that you should be in a certain college. Like some colleges, just it's not a good idea for a certain major. But let me break it down. So Revel is generally speaking known as like the life sciences and like just general science college. So like a lot of physics, a lot of chem, or not as much physics, but a lot of chem and a lot of bio. Muir is kind of, I feel like the everyman's college,
yeah.
Just because their GEs are super flexible, and they kind of shape them towards whatever your major is. So Muir, I don't think there's one specific pegged major. Warren is kind of known, I think, as like the engineering school.
Definitely, because their GEs are easier if you're an engineering major.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's like definitely if you're considering engineering, like that's where you'd want to be. Sixth College, I want to say, is art and technology.
I would say so. Yeah.
Yeah. So art and technology for Sixth. ERC and Marshall are the ones where I'm not really sure
it's
on those.
Like, I think they have like a lot of poli sci, political science.
Yeah, probably
and
so.
Economics,
history, sociology,
well.
English, or a lot of
social sciences.
Social sciences. Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, so that's how the college system works here. So it's like you can take Hume with like your science friends, but you also might have like a random history major there. So yeah, everyone has to take the GEs in those college, no matter what major you are. It's a lot easier to graduate on time if you're in a certain college with a certain major. But yeah, back to talking about the writing courses. Hume isn't the worst thing in the world. You survive.
Yeah, that's true. It's not awful. It's not as bad as some people make it out to be, I think.
Yeah, I think it's true. But that's us.
I only took Muir 40 so far, so I have to take MCWP. That's the writing course. It's got 50 next year. But it's not bad. A lot of the writing courses I've took so far, you have, like, it's not a lot of writing necessarily. It's just really in-depth. Like, you have two essays, and that's your grade, and, like, a final. So it's not a lot of work, per se. It's just you have to put a lot of time into that one piece that's going to decide your grade the moment. So it's not, you know, it's not hard to handle. It's just how much you put into it. Yeah.
And we'll take a break for now, and we'll be right back.
All right, we'll come back to...
Hey, welcome back. So we're going to answer a few more questions and or maybe just give you guys more tips on campus life at UCSD. So,
wait. we wanted to talk to you about.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's right. ERC, jeez. Yeah.
So, ERC, if you're a science major and you're in ERC, I hope you like diversity, because ERC's not exactly efficient for science majors. Like, ERC writing, you have a five sequence writing course, you have regional specialization, you have a few math and science courses in there, but you'll probably have to take those anyway. And then you have your language. So if you're anywhere in the social sciences and you're looking for efficiency, yeah, ERC. But for me, since I'm a biochem cell bio major and I'm in ERC, I get the experience of like social science classes with MMW and ethnic studies and all that, but I also have my bio classes and my chem classes for my major. So I like it because I get a feel for everything, but as far as efficiency goes, I'm gonna be here for 4 years.
All right.
Okay, so one thing I was thinking we should talk about are like the facilities that are on campus that we think are helpful. So for example, you shouldn't just be studying or just partying. I think you should also do some exercise as well. I definitely should, because I've been getting a bit rounder by the day.
That freshman 15.
Yeah.
Freshman negative 15. I did not know that was a thing until I showed up, and I was like, oh, negative 15. Okay.
It's funny, because it's really true. I gained exactly 15 pounds.
Did you really?
Exactly 15.
Really?
It's really funny. Yeah, exactly 15 pounds.
So there's a few facilities where you can go exercise, like between Revel and Muir is the main gym and the swimming pool. That's just one of the small places. But then at between Marshall and ERC is REMAC. That's the biggest one. It has all, pretty much all the facilities you want, a weight room.
That's the big gym.
Yeah. Basketball courts, volleyball.
Racquetball.
Yeah. Even a dance studio room.
Yeah,
dance
studio.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you gotta sign a waiver before you.
Oh yeah, yeah.
You can work out there.
Yeah, if you want to work out any of the facilities, you have to go to REMAC first.
Yeah, yeah. You have to go there. You can't do that at Maine. You have to go to REMAC if you want to work out at. You have to go to REMAC if you want to work out at Maine, or REMAC or any of the facilities. And you gotta take a towel.
Oh yeah. Sometimes they don't catch you.
Sometimes they don't catch you, but sometimes you always get that one, the asshole, that stickler.
Yeah.
Like, you got a towel on you.
I've cut a towel into quarters before with my friends. I brought mine and they didn't have theirs, and they were like, "No, you gotta have that towel." So I went, took their scissors, and just cut it into quarters.
That,
like,
you can
there
do
you
that.
Go.
Yeah, you can do that. I mean, you know.
Well, but sometimes the people that are checking, especially in main gym, they don't really care because they're just on their computers,
right?
Either watching Netflix or studying or playing a game.
Right. But yeah, just some things to note, because it sucks to make a walk all the way to REMAC just to be turned, you know, to be told that. Usually they'll make an exception. They'll be like, okay, well, you know, just next time bring your towel or whatever, and also have your ID. But even if you don't have your ID, your student ID, you can just give them your PID number.
Really?
Sometimes they'll.
Oh, I've never gotten.
You can just do that. Yeah. Because, I mean, you know, nobody's that messed up to be like, oh, you know, you don't have your ID, so.
And also, they also, you can borrow, like, basketballs or different equipment. Yeah, like, oh, at main gym, there's also, like, a sand volleyball court, and there's also where all the tennis courts are at. Are there any other tennis courts other than?
I think there's some tennis courts on, like, far north campus, like, the village, if you keep going up.
Right, so the ones are, there's the mirror courts, right? Or those, oh, those are, like, in front of mirror, right?
Yeah, it's, like, right there.
And there's also a soccer field there.
Yeah, and then you have the ones in, like, next to Goodies, I guess.
There's that one awkward tennis court. It's, like,
right
next
there.
To Goodies.
Oh,
like, yeah, that one, yeah.
And, like, ERC dorms have, like, a basketball court, right?
Do we?
There was one.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah, just one.
It's like right next to the laundry.
I think there's like
around
a basketball court in almost every college.
Yeah, Revel has them, Warren has them.
Yeah.
I was going to say something else, but something to note as well with the gyms. They do have really crazy hours where they can get, where it's like, sometimes it'll be super and crazy packed. They have this thing where it's like there's the outside ring and then there's the inner pit. The inner pit is usually open to everyone, but I'd say about like 30 to 40% of the time, it's only for student athletes who can work out in there.
Oh, yeah.
And when that happens, it's like, it is so hard to get the machine you want.
I think that's usually between the hours of like 4 to 6 a lot of times. So that's when teams are practicing, 4 to 6. Because, like, I remember I went and it was like, maybe it was like 4:30, and they're like, oh, yeah, we're going to be here till the pit's going to be busy till 6 or till 5 something.
Yeah. But as students, it's all free to us, so that's that's really good.
Yeah.
Although you'll sometimes see like some adults or some people outside of UCSD coming into their facilities, but they have to pay and we don't.
Which is nice. It's free, and like it's already getting taken out of like tuition, so you might as well go. It's like a nice gym. It's a legitimate, like,
it's
you can
good.
Get a good workout.
It's really
there.
Good. It's really good. Yeah. So much equipment. You know, for whatever kind of workout program you're doing, you can pretty much do it there because they have all the equipment for it.
Mm-hmm. And like staying on the topic of like physical and recreation, if you are more like not as much into working out as much as you like sports or that kind of thing, they also have the what are they called, intramural sports.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I've played intramural soccer twice. I've done indoor and outdoor. I really liked it. It was really fun. They have intramural and they also have club, which are both. Club is a little bit more competitive. It's almost like an official UCSD team, but it's still intramural. It's more like you play against other schools, but it's not at the same level. Like, there's not as much competition. It's a lot more relaxed, less of a time requirement. But, yeah, intramural was really fun. I did co-ed, so they had to have, I think it was, like, 3 girls, 3 boys. They have that stupid rule that I'm sure every girl who plays soccer hates, where it's, like, a girl scores, it's worth 2 points. A guy scores, it's worth 1. Hate that.
Really?
I didn't know.
I didn't know that was a thing.
It is absolutely a thing. But, I mean, aside from that,
it
was really great.
Really?
What? I remember that happening in middle school. Like, if we played flag football, if a girl catches it, it's 3 points. But if a guy catches it,
but that's so, like...
Yeah, I mean, they could have changed it. It was 2 years ago that I did that. So it was my first year, my second year I played. So it could have changed.
That really surprises me, though, that, you know, because it's all about...
Equality
and all that inclusion.
I mean,
and they do that.
UCSD isn't that diverse.
Yeah.
To be honest.
Yeah.
It's just a lot of Asian people.
Yeah, but that's true. But I mean, like, aside from that, like, the people we played with were all really nice. Like, no one was super competitive. But yeah, I definitely recommend doing intramural sports with your friends. So.
And also, if you're a Muir, if you're going to live on campus at Muir, we also have our own intramural league where the houses play each other. I'm not sure if any of the other colleges do that. Yeah, so that's right?
Like, in different sports? All I know is, like, water polo, I think.
Yeah, I mean,
like,
but that's first quarter. And second quarter, it was dodgeball. And this quarter, I think it's basketball and volleyball. But yeah, so if you're going to be living in Muir, you could look forward to that, especially if you don't want to. If you want even less commitment than being in the intramural team, then you can just go to your house team and play every so often, just with your friends. Oh, and also, another cool thing that UCSD has is the Price Center Theater. And occasionally, they have free screenings of movies. For example, the latest one was La La Land. And let's see, our two producers, Alex, David, and I, we went to stand in line for that movie. And because of how popular it was, we couldn't even get in.
Oh, really?
Oh. Literally, like... The line was so long, it reached, like, Library Walk.
What?
Like...
Some PC to Library Walk.
Priest Theater.
Like the Infinite Falls.
Right?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, past the stairs, and then, like... it was like... We were near the end of the line. We came in, like, 15 minutes before we could get in, but then even that wasn't early enough. But last time, David and I did go to see Moonlight, and we did get in to see that because Moonlight isn't as well known as La La Land.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely, that's just a free movie you can watch, so that's a good thing to look out for.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Any other... Oh, and also, let's talk about Geisel. Do you guys study at Geisel?
Yeah, only during finals.
Yeah, just a handful of times in the 4 years that I've been here.
Yeah,
because, you know, I don't know, I just, I've always been able to study in my room. It's,
mm-hmm.
it's, you know, I find it more distracting to have to go, you know, go to Geisel.
I get that. Yeah,
and then go
just
back to my room, and then, you know, just
Well, see, if you're an ERC, you're going to become very familiar with Geisel.
Oh, really?
Like MMW 13, you have to create your own research topic for a research paper, and you have to use books that are found in Geisel.
Oh, really?
And you have to scan them and
man.
Highlight them. So
you're
going to become very familiar with Geisel if you're an ERC. For MMW 13,
Yeah, for some classes, you might have to use it as a resource. Like, I took some classes you wouldn't even expect. I took a class on the Beatles, like a popular music class, and I had to do a research paper on them, and I had to go check out books on the Beatles. In Geisel, you know, about their films and about their music and stuff like that. And Yeah, it was interesting. I had to check out like 3 different books for that.
And the second floor is open 24/7, or at least the east wing is. So you could, if say your roommates are snoring loudly, you could always go there to study.
Yeah, the basement's also 24 hours.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, basement's cool. 24 hours. Did you want to go into you say something?
Oh, no. I mean, guys, it's okay. I only go there if, like, I have to. Like, there's a study session, but the top floors are so eerie. Like,
oh, yeah, it's so quiet.
Because it's so free in the bottom floors, and the higher you go, the quieter it gets, and people are really serious about studying. Like, you pull out a chair, and people are like,
they look at you.
They're like, I'm going to kill you.
Yeah, you're breathing and just...
And then, like, renting rooms. If someone's in your room, you're just like, I don't want to interrupt them. But guys, it's okay. If you like studying public places, but... The biomed library, like, more.
Yeah,
the biomed is much better.
There's plenty of places in each college to study, even in your own suite. Like, I know for Demure dorms, there's, like what they call a nerd room.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And you just lock yourself off.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Fleets and Revelle had that, too. It's, like, the bottom floor usually was a quiet study place, but a lot of times it's, like, a movie place where people would just be hanging out.
Yeah,
But during midterm season and final season, it's definitely, like, it is... People are just there studying.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I think I pulled... I don't want to call it an all-nighter. I think it was, like, it was an almost all-nighter. I was up to, like, 6 studying chem. I was going to fall asleep. I remember it so well. I was listening to Papa Roach just on repeat, like, the loudest, most, like...
Oh, man.
Song that I would not fall asleep against. But, yeah, that's their... Yeah, dorms usually have a place somewhere nearby.
For sure.
Mm. Yeah, sorry, did you want to talk about...
I was going to say you wanted to go into sports at all, like UCSD sports teams.
Yeah, sure. So UCSD sports were in Div 2, and honestly, I'm not too familiar with sports.
Okay. You know?
Me neither.
I can kind of talk a little bit about it. I'm not super familiar about it either, but... Well, one thing I didn't know is we've been a Division II school for the longest time, so we tried going D1. Like, we voted on it as a campus last year. It raised our tuition a little bit. And apparently we got rejected?
Yeah, we got rejected.
So, I mean, that kind of sucks.
Especially for the paying students.
Yeah. But aside from that, one thing a lot of students, like, I remember happened a lot my first year, students don't always realize UC San Diego does not have a football team. Like, that is not a thing that is here. There was one once upon a time, very long time ago. The sports that I think are the sports where UCSD ranks highest or does, like, gets the most attention, I think is women's soccer. I want to say volleyball.
I was going to say volleyball, yeah.
And I think water polo.
Water polo.
Yeah,
water polo.
I think those are the 3 sports for the most part where UCSD does really well. We have all the other kind of teams. Like, there's a rowing team, there's basketball, there's volleyball, there's tennis. But you generally don't hear too much about them. Like, the school definitely is one of those schools where it's like you hear everyone going to that, like, Friday night football game or basketball game. Although once a year they have Spirit Night, where they have the men's and women's basketball team play another school, and they treat it like a big rally. I think that I've only went twice and we lost both games both years naturally. But yeah, it's definitely like we're not a, like, if you're super into like heavy duty sports, like following them,
yeah,
probably like you're gonna want to look to like SDSU.
We don't have too much school spirit when it comes to sports.
Yeah, so, but I mean, it's like it's just such a small part though of our college
experience.
Yeah,
there's so much more to it.
Do we have a baseball team?
Yes,
yeah,
we do have a baseball team.
Yeah.
I never even heard of
it. I've been to the one of their games. I don't remember anything about it.
I mean, yeah, there's a baseball team.
Also, let's talk about not all your time at UCSD is going to be for academics or whatever time you're going to spend on campus. There's also many places you can go off campus, including UTC. And there's a lot of...
That's a popular one.
Yeah, that's a pretty, it's a mall... There's an ice rink there. If you're an Apple guy, there's an Apple store. And also, there's the ArcLight.
Yeah.
I wouldn't recommend going there because it's expensive.
Everywhere here is expensive.
Yeah,
AMC,
but
ArcLight.
More so than AMC.
They have a thing, though. I think like on Saturdays or something in the mornings, tickets are like $8.
What?
Yeah.
You know what really sucks,
like
though?
Is it like a regular matinee?
I'm not sure, but like I remember we went to go see Logan for like $8 or $9.
I definitely paid $16
on a Saturday morning. It was pretty good.
They charge like an extra $2 or $3 on holidays. It sucks.
Yeah, you gotta check these things they have going on, these opportunities, I guess.
But yeah, I like UTC. I went there a lot more my first few couple years. I think it was, we would do it as like a apartment, or not apartment, dorm binding or suite binding, where we'd go like bonding. Not binding. Sweet bonding.
Yeah.
Wrong word there. where we would all go as a group to UTC, and like usually we would get dinner. I remember I went ice skating for the first time.
Yeah.
And it was like, it's really pretty there too. Like even if you're not going there to buy anything, like it's really fun to just like walk around, like people watch. It's like an outdoor mall, I guess, essentially.
Oh yeah.
And that was also if you're into, if you're getting really tired of campus food or want to cook yourself, there's always Ralph's you can go to. It's just like a few bus stops away. And by the way, which is free because we're with your student ID.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's pretty much everything you need. Pretty local, I feel.
Any other places you guys go to? Because I live almost exclusively on campus. I almost never leave.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, yeah, when you live on campus, you like to order food a lot also.
Oh, yeah, you can just deliver.
There's a lot of great delivery.
Like Domino's.
Domino's is probably one of the best delivery options. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I know a lot of people like to order, you know, Indian food or like...
What restaurants do you guys like outside of campus? Like mine,
Islands.
My favorite is Pokerito.
Pokerito, what's that?
You know the Poke?
Oh, I know Poke, but I've never heard of, like...
So, it's, like, it's sort of, like, a Poke plus Mexican fusion, but, I mean, not too much Mexican food goes into it. Like, you can get a Poke burrito, and also, but my favorite is the Poke bowl, and you just put a lot of different stuff into it. You could also, I guess you could put guacamole in it, which is, you know, Mexican, but tastes really good, and it's also not too pricey, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
At least
and
for the quality.
You can order that onto campus?
No, you have to go there.
Oh, yes,
go
there. Oh, okay.
Just restaurants.
It's at the Convoy.
Oh, Convoy. Oh, have you guys been to Convoy?
I don't know.
So.
Oh,
no.
God.
Oh,
that's where all
should...
the good Asian food
is. Yeah, are you guys familiar with it at all?
Don't think so.
Oh, it's like, it's kind of like, San Diego doesn't really have like a Asian, like a Chinatown or anything like that, but it's like, I'd say it's the closest thing to that. It's basically like this long road where it has like a 99 Ranch, a ton of different restaurants. Pretty much anything that is like Asian, from like Japanese, Korean, Chinese, it has all of those restaurants and grocery stores. And the food there is amazing. Like, it is
definitely so
good. You can get, I think it's like an hour long bus ride to get there, but honestly, it's like it's a Saturday and you're bored and you want to get like a really nice lunch, you guys should definitely check it out. It's pretty good. Oh, Vallarta's. That's another one.
Oh, yeah, Vallarta's.
Yeah,
yeah,
have you guys been to Vallarta's?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
Carne asada fries.
Or that California burrito.
Oh, yeah.
It's not really Mexican food, but it tastes good.
Well, you can get a California burrito now on campus from Taco Villa.
Yeah.
You guys been there?
We just went there.
Oh,
yeah,
really?
Yeah,
my
yeah,
go-to
yeah.
is
like
so
it?
Good.
Do you like it? It's
yeah,
pretty good.
It's really good.
It definitely...
chicken.
I know. Yeah.
Yeah. Since we're on the topic of food, though, I think it needs to be clarified that at Price Center... you cannot use dining dollars.
Like,
some people get this idea, or they just think, wait, maybe there's somewhere here I could use dining dollars. No, Price Center is all, you know, money, just all real money.
Yeah, or you can use try and cash.
Or try and cash, yeah. Yeah.
Which is essentially just real money.
Yeah, at this point,
but
yeah.
No dining dollars there.
Because, like, they're their own businesses, but then you can only use dining dollars for HDH markets and dining halls, because that's the currency that they administer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just... save some people trouble and embarrassment.
But at least like dining dollars, even though it's expensive, you don't pay tax for it.
Yeah,
so that's
true.
One good thing.
Yeah. Price Center is, I live off campus now, but on my like long days where it's like I'm going to be on campus for like 10 hours straight, I go to PC usually.
Yeah.
Just as like, it's really crowded in there, but I mean, if you can find a place to sit, and there's like a ton of different restaurants.
There's
like
so many, yeah.
Panda Express, there's Round Table, Jamba Juice, Tapex,
Santorini,
Subway, and
Bombay Coast.
Yeah, they have a Subway. That's right.
Yeah, it's
Starbucks.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty cool. Yeah.
There's the Shogun.
Shogun, the sushi place.
And Rubio's.
Mm-hmm.
Personally, I like Rubio's because just. They have shrimp in their burrito, so.
Yeah, so PC is pretty convenient. So it's like if you've had way too much, dining food, you can definitely go there.
Treat yourself.
There's also Hai Thai on campus. I've only had their mango and Thai iced teas.
Oh yeah.
Have you guys had their like actual?
I had their like watermelon boba. It was like okay. Tapex is better though.
Tapex
okay.
is better boba. Yeah.
Although I think their food sucks. Tapex food really.
I've never had it. I'm
like
just their drinks.
I've had their calamari.
Is it calamari?
Oh my! Oh, I can only like. three pieces of that and it's good, and then suddenly it tastes terrible. Same goes for a chicken.
I personally was hooked on the spice
they add to it. It's better just to get no spice, because the spice is just fake. They just like sprinkle it on and it's like, hey, it's spicy, but it's really not. It's like,
I think people either really love it or really hate it. I know people who are really crazy about tapioca. I'm kind of one of those.
Are you really?
I really like tapioca. I don't know. It's different from other stuff, I guess.
Yeah, their taro iced tea is not bad. That's basically it.
So do any of you guys own cars?
No. I
do.
Don't.
You?
Do you?
No, I do not. No. But something you should be aware of is student parking.
I think everyone's familiar with that, whether you got a car or not.
To park on campus, you have to get parking permits, and there's a different type of parking permits because there are different type of parking spaces. I think the most common one is S, is it?
Yeah.
S. So there's most common one, but still not enough, because you should also know that they sell more parking permits than there are spaces, because I guess it kind of makes sense, because not everyone's going to be parked at the same time, because some of them will be on campus and some of them will be off, but still, it's pretty hard to get parking.
Like, if you're a commuter, like, I know students who will like get up 2-3 hours before they have class to be on campus. And even then they may not get a spot.
It's a struggle. Also, like, living on campus kind of thing, things have changed quite a bit, huh? Like, I came in like 2013, so I've lived here all 4 years on campus, because I got 4-year guarantee. They used to guarantee you 4 years. Now it's like they will only guarantee
two.
Two.
So, but then you can still get into the village. Or, do you know what the chances of that are?
The village? I don't know. I know my the people I lived with my freshman sophomore year, they still, like, I left because I studied abroad, but they stayed together, and they're in the village now. And it didn't seem like it was too hard, at least for the two of them together. Like, maybe if you have a big group, it's difficult. But if it's just you and a friend or you and a couple of friends, I don't think it's too bad.
I
guess we should mention, the village is the one housing on campus where I think college does not matter. It's like, I think you can be any college living in the village. But I'm pretty sure it's sophomores to seniors only. Like, there's no real freshmen there.
It's even further to the border of campus than ERC.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like the furthest point of campus. So it's like, if you live in the village and you have class, like,
most
at
north.
Center Hall, which is like the center of campus, it's a hike.
Yeah.
Like, it is a long walk.
Yeah, only advantage is you're a bit closer to REMAC.
I would recommend either getting like a longboard or a bicycle.
Or a scooter.
Or a scooter, yes.
Scooters.
Or Heelys.
And if you do get a definitely Heelys. And if you do get a bike, make sure you get a good U-lock and know how to properly lock your bike, because there are many bike thieves at UCSD.
Yeah.
Even better, just bring it into your room if you have no space.
But just don't be that asshole that is on the hoverboard. Because I'm sure a few of us have seen, there's like a couple
hoverboards
here. They move slower than the crowd does.
Yeah.
So it's like when it's in the middle of like between passing periods, and like the library walk is just swamped with people, and there's just this guy like cruising on a, you're just like, just don't do that.
Like, come on, man.
Just please don't do that.
Sure. On the topic of crowds, if you are going to bring some sort of vehicle, be careful. Like, I thought about bringing a bike because I had to go from York to Warren, but then I switched my classes so I don't have to anymore. But I'm like, I'm going to run over at least 5 people a day. Like, it gets so crowded.
I
couldn't handle it.
No, I've seen some pretty nasty, like, mishaps. Like, I saw two guys on bikes just full-on collision into each other, and they just, like, it was messy.
That's great.
But only one of the guys fell off his bike. The other guy
stayed impressive. It's like a game of chicken. Maybe the bottom was.
Probably the heavier guy stayed on his bike, and the other guy got, like, flipped.
Also, do you guys use the shuttle at all?
Yeah, I've used it a few times.
Oh, yeah.
Occasionally, yeah.
Definitely.
So I haven't used it, so could you guys tell me about it?
You haven't used it? Oh.
No.
Which shuttle? The campus shuttle? Like, the loop, or the...
There are different types of shuttles.
Well, you know, there's different stops at all around campus that can take you, you know, basically goes in a loop around the campus. There's a clockwise and a counterclockwise loop, so depending on where you need to get to, one is going to be better for you. But usually at each stop there's a counterclockwise and a clockwise stop.
So how often do they come by?
15 minutes,
they say 15 minutes, but sometimes it can take a little longer. it can take a little longer. You have to really, you can track the shuttles, actually. They have an app, I think.
Oh, really?
Or you can Google it. You can Google UCSD shuttle camp, or you can even text. I think they have a number you can text. It'll tell you when it's arriving, or So yeah, you know, it's good to get around campus.
It's a big one, so the shuttles make a big difference, especially when it's pouring rain out.
Yeah. Like, it's so crowded.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I swear to God, it's probably going to rain the beginning of next year, because like it did for the last 2 years.
Mm.
Like first week it was pouring. Mm-hmm. It's like, I came to UCSD for the weather, and
it gets cold here.
Okay, it also gets kind of cold, and yeah, especially at night.
Yeah.
And windy sometimes, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and if you're taking a campus shuttle, make sure it has like a sign that has a yellow L in it that says
lit. Yeah, not.
Because you don't want to take like the SIO
the scripts.
Or scripts. If you're actually trying to take a campus loop, make sure it's the campus loop, because mm-hmm. you could end up on the wrong bus.
Yeah, I've had a few friends who've done that and will end up like super far away, like way off campus, and then they're like, oh, oops.
Yeah, so if you have to just ask the driver and they'll tell you.
Yeah, it's a common question.
Do any of you guys have any part-time jobs you're doing?
Part-time
jobs? I've held a variety of jobs actually on campus. The first one I did, I worked at Sixth Market for 2 years. It was super flexible. Like, if you're trying to find a job and or if like you really need one, I highly recommend going with HDH. Not because I didn't like it, or actually like I hated it, to be honest, but they paid really, really well. And I don't know what's happening right now. Okay. I guess we're gonna go ahead and just call it real quick. We'll come back in a minute. Oh, finish that. No, we'll take a break and then we'll come back. Oh, all right, cool.
Okay, welcome back. So we'll there's just some camera problems going on. So yeah, and if you're looking for extra, you know, pocket money, there's always HDH. They're always hiring. There's some more competitive jobs, like working at the library, because that's super easy. You don't have to get yourself dirty.
Or Remac, right? As the
oh yeah, just yeah. sit down, take someone's card, scan it,
yeah,
done.
Yeah,
and mm-hmm. just and make sure people have their towels.
If you want to be yeah. that guy,
yeah.
There's a lot of jobs on campus. Yeah. Yeah, Remac is one. Pretty much any job where it's like there's a call center. That's like they hire a lot of students. HDH hires the most on campus.
Oh yeah.
Which is like housing, dining, hospitality. So you could work for the dorms. You could work at the dining halls or at the grocery stores.
Mm.
Yeah.
The markets is, in my opinion, the easiest one, just because they have the most flexible hours. And plus, HDH schedule, like, you'll only get, like, 3-hour shifts, so they work really well with classes instead of, like,
as
6 hours.
As someone that works at HDH, not true. Sometimes it's 3 hours.
Really?
Sometimes it goes to 4.5 hours.
Oh, okay, yeah, I guess that's true. But it kind of depends on your managers.
Yeah.
Weekend hours, even, you know,
yeah,
as well.
Currently I work at the CASP office, which is like a student services office at the Student Services Center. They're super flexible, but there's a lot of jobs.
Yeah, and what about like, I guess we didn't talk too much about grades, you know, like how you're gonna score relative to your, you know, peers is gonna matter a lot.
Yeah.
You know, so like there's, you know, the curve, right? They call it the curve. Just cause you get like a 50% in an exam, and if a lot of people got that much, you know, near that much, you'll be fine, probably. You'll pass.
What was it like when you guys left, like, going from high school grading, ratings or whatever, and then going into, like, the college version of how grades come out?
I feel like I wasn't prepared for the classes here.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I never took calculus in high school. I took chemistry 10th grade and came back and tried to take chem in college.
Oh,
like,
same.
So I passed my classes, but I was struggling with a lot of things. So the grade difference there was large. But then in classes I did well in high school, like writing and all that sort of history, I did really well here. So there's like a disparity, but I mean,
yeah,
it's about experience, I guess. Because I know some friends who did better, and they took, like, AP subjects and stuff, and that's where, like, the practical use of taking those advanced classes comes
mm-hmm.
in.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, there was a big shift, but I wasn't worrying too much about it. And it really depends how you do comparative to others, because if you're all failing, well, then, you know.
You're all passing.
Yeah. Like, a 30% can be a passing grade.
Like,
not always.
Worry if someone's getting, like, if the average is 70 and you're getting 40, then there's a problem.
Yeah, just a piece of advice. I mean, don't let the freedom get to you when you come out here, you know, because it's pretty easy to let that sense of freedom, you know, you know, where you think you have a lot of time, or, you know, you don't have to go to your classes and stuff, and then, you know, that could actually hurt you, you know, if you don't study regularly, because nobody's there to tell you to study, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And if whatever habits you had in high school, they might not cut it, you know, here for success, you know.
I agree. It's a lot about discipline.
Definitely. Oh my god.
Fall quarter, I was actually on my shit. Like, I was kind of, I'm not going to brag, but I think I was pretty disciplined as far as studying goes. And Oasis has workshops for some of the science and math classes, so I was enrolled in a few of those.
Yeah.
And, you know, yeah. I had a lot of time. I studied quite a bit. Winter quarter wasn't a discipline, the grade show. But it's, if you keep it on yourself to do the work and put in the time, you'll be fine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you guys have anything else to add about UCC?
Any final thoughts? Don't be worried about waitlists in classes.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Don't stress too much about, especially as a first year. You will get your classes, just,
yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, yeah.
Don't forget to take some fun ones, too.
Definitely. And I think we'll wrap that up right here. Thanks for watching our fifth episode. And hopefully, for you incoming freshmen, you'll watch more of this, and you'll have a good time. UCSD.
Just want to leave one more thing in, actually, real quick. Sorry. If you guys have additional questions, you can post them in the comment section, and we'll try and answer them.
Definitely.
So.
All right, okay. Then.
Bye. Bye.